We start today with our first lecture of Professor Natasha Sezun from University of Pennsylvania. She's going to talk about on complete gradient shrinking rich solutions.
Thanks a lot for the invitation. It's my pleasure to be here, and happy birthday, Marcus. So yesterday, Jorge told us something about the Ricci flow and the Ricci solitons, and I will repeat a little bit to make some introduction, and then I will start with some new things. So let me write down the Ricci flow equation. So let me first say that this is a joint work with Olivio Monteanu. Okay, so here is the Ricci flow equation. So ddt gij is negative 2 times rij, where g of 0 is some initial metric g0. And even if you start on a compact, like let's say we start on a compact manifold with a smooth Riemannian metric g0, it is very likely that this flow will develop a singularity at some finite time capital t. And we would like to understand the formation of those singularities. So what you usually do, you actually dilate your solution in space and time around the singularity, and then take the limit. And then, what we get in the limit, we usually call the singularity models. So understanding those singularity models is equivalent to understanding the singularities of the Ricci flow, and the Ricci solitons very often arise as those singularity models of the Ricci flow equation. So let me give you a definition of the Ricci solitons. So Mg is a Ricci soliton if there exists a vector field V and some constant rho so that the following equation is satisfied. Rij plus the lead derivative of metric G in the direction of this vector field V is equal to rho times Gij. And if you this constant rho can be positive, equal to 0, or less than 0, and depending on that, you have a shrinking, steady, and expanding soliton, respectively. Okay, so and this is equivalent to saying that actually g of t is a solution to the Ricci flow equation. So this is our Ricci flow. Such that this g of t is 1 minus 2 rho t and times the pullback of the initial metric g0 by diffeomorphisms phi sub t that are generated by this vector field v over 1 minus 2 rho t. Okay. So this is so that means that these the Ricci solitons are the solutions to the Ricci flow equation that move by one parameter family of diffeomorphisms. So that means that if you change your equation by diffeomorphisms, then you will see these Ricci solitons as the fixed points, as the stationary points of your equation. And you can see that these are the generalizations, natural generalizations of Einstein metrics, because for example, when you take V to be zero, then you just get an Einstein metric. Okay. So the question is, so why are these Ricci solitons important? So I already mentioned the reason, which is the studying of the singularities, but also these Ricci solitons, for example, they happen to vanish on the quantities that that appear to be monotone along the Ricci flow, including the Perelman's monotone functional. So these solitons vanish on those. So actually, this functional vanishes on those solitons. So that's how sometimes you can guess what the monotone quantity should be, something that should vanish on those Ricci solitons. So they vanish on the monotone quantities are along the flow. So, and I mentioned, yes, and the other thing that I mentioned, that the Ricci solitons arise as singularity models. Which again means that they arise as limit of a sequence of dilations in space and time of your solution around the singularities. Okay, so for example, what you can have in mind, for example, if you take a dumbbell, okay, where this neck is like S2 cross B1, then what you expect this neck to pinch off in some finite time. So the neck just becomes like thinner and shorter. Because the positive curvature in S2 direction will dominate slightly negative curvatures in B1 direction. And so that means that the singularity will happen at some finite time capital T. And if you dilate this picture around the singularity here, then what you expect to get is just a cylinder, S2 cross R. Okay, and this was actually justified by Anginant and Knopf in 2005. And they proved for some suitably chosen initial data which are rotationally symmetric on Sn plus 1, this is exactly what happens. Okay, and this corresponds to type 1 singularities. And then I also want to mention a result of Huaidong Cao, who actually proved, so let me just tell you what type 1 and type 2 singularity is. So we will say that the solution has a type 1 singularity if the supremum of m of t times t minus t is less than plus infinity, where m of t is just the supremum of the norm of the Riemannian curvature at time t. So, and type 2 singularity is the one for which this supremum is equal to infinity. Okay. So then there is a result of Huaidong Cao, which says that any type 2 singularity model of the Ricci, of the Kähler-Ricci flow, with non-negative holomorphic bisectional curvature, and positive Ricci curvature, is a gradient steady soliton. Okay. Also, okay, I will mention the result of me that says that any compact type 1 singularity model which again means the limit of dilations around the singularity. So singularity model is the limit of dilations around the singularity. So you see here in the case of a type 2 singularity, in the case of the Kähler-Ricci flow with no negative holomorphic bisectional curvature and Ricci curvature positive, we always have a gradient steady soliton as a singularity model. And I proved that any compact type 1 singularity model of the Ricci flow is a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton. So I will use this abbreviation for a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton. Okay, and I proved that just by using Perelman's monotonicity formula. And then after that, Naber, he generalized this result and he proved that a suitable rescaling of any type 1 singularity is a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton. So this singularity model doesn't have necessarily to be compact. So in his case, and what happens usually is a complete. So, but still he can get it a gradient Ricci soliton, but we still here don't know whether this singularity model is non-trivial, namely that it's not flat. So that's a... Okay. So let me just first tell you the plan of the talk. So in the first part of the talk, I want to give some estimates for these gradient shrinking Ricci solitons, which will lead to a simplified proof of classification of gradient shrinking Ricci solitons in the locally conformally flat case. So that will be the first part of the talk. And in the second half, I want to talk about the existence of harmonic functions on those gradient shrinking Ricci solitons and gradient steady Ricci solitons, because it is known that the existence of harmonic functions with bounded Dirichlet energy is related to the structure of the underlying manifold. Namely, it's related to the number of ends of the underlying manifold. So in the second part, as I said, I want to talk about the existence of harmonic functions on gradient shrinking Ricci solitons and gradient steady Ricci solitons, because this is related to the number of ends. Okay, so let me first start with some known results about the Ricci soliton. So I will mention the result of Hamilton and Ivy that says that every compact steady or expanding Ricci soliton is necessarily Einstein. Okay. Then there is also an important result of Perelman that says that every compact Ricci soliton is a gradient Ricci soliton. So in the compact case, so all Ricci solitons are gradient. Okay, maybe I just forgot to mention what the gradient soliton is. So just so you remember that the equation of our soliton was Rij plus the lead derivative of V. Ij is rho times Gij. And in the case when V is the gradient of some function f, in that case, we have a gradient Ricci soliton. And then this term here just becomes the Hessian of F. Okay. And I will also mention that what the definition of a gradient Kähler-Ricci, a Kähler-Ricci soliton. So in the definition of the gradient Kähler-Ricci soliton, namely if your manifold is also Kähler, you require this V to be a holomorphic vector field. So that means that you have the equations R alpha beta bar plus gradient alpha gradient beta bar of F is equal to rho times G alpha beta bar. And the fact that V is holomorphic, that means that F alpha beta is the same as F alpha bar beta bar, which is zero. Okay. So we will use this also later in the talk. Okay, so I said that Perelman proved that every compact Ricci soliton has to be a gradient. And then there is also a result of Hamilton in dimension n equals to 2 and Ivy in dimension n equals to 3 that says that every gradient shrinking Ricci soliton is the one of positive constant curvature. And recently, this was generalized by Bohm and Wilking. From their result, it follows that whenever you take a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton now in any dimension with a positive curvature operator, it is isometric to the quotient of a sphere. Okay? So, and I also want to mention the result of Perelman, which actually motivates the first part of this talk. And he proved this result in dimension n equals to 3. That there is no complete, non-compact gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, which is kappa non-collapsed, and with positive and bounded sectional curvature. Okay. So due to this result, we actually have a classification of gradient shrinking Ricci solitons in dimension n equals to 3. So namely, as a corollary, we have that every gradient shrinking Ricci soliton in dimension n equals to 3, which is kappa non-collapsed with positive and bounded sectional curvature, is either S3 or S2 cross R, or their quotients. Okay? But this is a corollary of this Perelman's theorem under this hypothesis. And then people believed that these actually hypotheses are not necessary in dimension n equals to 3, and that turned out to be the case. Because there is a work of Lainey, Wallach, and Aber, who actually showed that this kappa non-collapsed can be dropped. Okay? And they replaced this positive sectional curvature by positive Ricci. And bounded sectional curvature they replaced by the fact that they allowed it at most the exponential growth of the curvature. So R of x is just a distance from a fixed point on your manifold. Okay, so they a little bit relaxed this hypothesis, and they obtained the same conclusion. And actually, this is a, yeah, okay. So now, in the end, there is a result of Cao, Chen, and Zhu, who actually removed both of these hypotheses. So by their observation, the theorem should be that every gradient shrinking Ricci soliton in dimension n equals to 3 is one of these. Okay, there are no assumptions. No assumptions. And they obtain the classification. So now the question is whether this result can be generalized to some higher dimensions. Can you have such a neat classification in higher dimensions? Well, now I will list some examples that show that you cannot expect to have such a classification in higher dimensions unless you assume something on the curvature. Okay, so let me give you some examples. So there is so on CP2, blown up at one point, Poisson and Tao found Cayley-Ricci gradient shrinking Ricci soliton with positive Ricci curvature. And this is not Einstein. Then on CP2, blown up at two points, Wang and Zhu also found the Cayley-Ricci gradient shrinking Ricci soliton. This one has a symmetry U of 2, and this one has a symmetry U of 1 cross U of 1. And then Feldman, Ilmanen, and Knopf. So they obtained an example of a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton in the complete case. These two are compact, but they obtained the result of, so they found a complete gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, which has positive scalar curvature, but the Ricci curvature changes its sign. Then when we talk about the steady solitons, I can give you some example of the steady solitons. For example, the in dimension n equals to 2, there is a famous example of Hamilton, which is just a cigar. And the generalization of that in higher dimensions was found by Bryant, and they are called now Bryant solitons. So cigars, they behave like cylinders at infinity with a finite circumference. And Bryant solitons, they open like paraboloids. OK, so all these examples actually suggest that you cannot have such a nice classification of gradient shrinking Ricci solitons as in three dimensions. And the reason why you have such a nice classification in this case is that in three dimensions, the Weyl curvature is vanishing. Right? So maybe what you can do in higher dimensions, you can assume Weyl is equal to 0, which is true, for example, in the locally conformally flat case. Okay? And many people actually worked with these locally conformally flat gradient shrinking Ricci solitons, and they obtained some results. And then I will just mention a few. So there is a result of, so they all assumed Weyl equal to 0. So there is a result of Lainey, Wallach, who assumed that Ricci is positive and that Riemannian grows at most exponentially. And then they obtained that all complete, so they obtained that all gradient shrinking Ricci solitons are Sn or Sn minus 1 cross R or the quotients. Okay. So under this hypothesis, you have a similar classification as in dimension n equals to 3. Then there is a work of Cao, Wang, and Zhang, who obtained the same classification, but assuming that the Ricci has a bound from below. And they obtained the same result. Then there is a work of Peterson and Willey, and they assumed that this integral of Ricci squared e to the negative f is less than infinity, which is not obvious if your manifold is complete. So under this assumption and Weyl equal to 0, they obtain the same classification. And finally, I'll mention a work of Z.H. Zhang, who proved that all gradient shrinking Ricci solitons with Weyl equal to 0 have non-negative sectional curvature. Okay. So now, if you combine this result and then you apply the result of Cao, Wang, and Zhang, you again get you actually get the full classification with no assumptions. Right. So this result is quite algebraic. So now we obtain some new estimates and identities for the gradient shrinking Ricci solitons. Without even assuming Weyl equal to 0. And then if you apply them to the case Weyl equal to 0, this gives a new simplified proof of this classification, which is also analytic. Okay, so let me state the theorem. Well, the first theorem is that if M is a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, so here we are not assuming that the val is zero, then the integral of Ricci squared e to the negative lambda f is less or equal than some constant that depends on lambda, which is less than infinity. And that this holds for every lambda bigger than zero. Yes, f is the potential function. Yeah. So then I will mention another theorem that says that if for some lambda less than 1, this integral of Rm squared e to the negative lambda f is less than infinity, then we have the following identity. Grad Ricci squared e to the negative f is the same as the integral over divergence of the curvature operator squared e to the negative f. And both these things are less than infinity. Okay. So if this holds for some lambda less than 1 for any gradient, so this is again true for any gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, then you have this identity and these both integrals are less than infinity. So I will say that Cao, Wang, and Zhang, they obtained the same identity here, but they needed to assume Ricci bounded from below, and the Riemannian curvature has at most the exponential growth. So now we are not, I mean, this is weaker than that, as you can see. Okay. So and in their proof of the classification, because I told you that they obtained the classification under this assumption, the place where they use this assumption is to prove this identity here. So since now we can prove it without that assumption, you imagine that we will have the, I mean, from their proof, the classification will immediately follow. So you don't need then to use the theorem of Zhang. Okay, so let me just first tell you some ingredients that we used in this proof. So of course we use the identities that are satisfied by Ricci solitons. So the first one is just the soliton equation. I will take this rho to be just 1/2, which you can always obtain by rescaling the metric. Then, then there is like this identity that was obtained by Hamilton, that r plus grad f squared is equal to f. In this case, well, and then there is another constant c, but by rescaling, actually changing f by a constant, you can make this c to be zero, and then you just get something like this. Then also you have that nabla I, rij e to the negative f is zero. Then nabla k, rij minus nabla I, nabla j, rik. Is R J K H I times F H. Okay, and all this actually you can obtain just by playing with the Ricci soliton equation and using the Bianchi identities, commuting the derivatives, and so on. Okay. So let me now first tell you how this classification follow from here. So of course, there are two approaches actually. So if you use the first theorem here, which says that Ricci squared e to the negative lambda f is always bounded, then you can just go to the proof of Peterson F. Willi and remove this assumption because it's automatically satisfied for any gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, and this tells you that in the locally conformally flat case, you will have the full classification. So you don't need this assumption. Okay, and the other approach is the following. So proof of the classification. Okay, so the first approach, so use, so let me call this theorem A and this theorem B. So use theorem A plus Peterson and Willis theorem. And in the second approach, like since Weyl is zero, that means that the Riemannian curvature tensor is controlled by the Ricci, so which means that the Riemannian square e to the negative lambda f is less or equal than a constant times Ricci squared e to the negative lambda f, and it is bounded by theorem A again. So now by theorem B, we have that this integral of gradient Ricci squared e to the negative f is the same as divergence of Riemann square e to the negative f, which is bounded again. And now you can just go to the proof. So use the rest of the proof of Cao, Chen, and Zhang to obtain the classification. So actually, the proof of theorem A is very easy. And I'll just, so it's just a couple of lines. I'll just show you. The proof of theorem B is somewhat more computation, so I will not present it here. But theorem A is pretty straightforward. Yeah, and since we now have this nice estimates for gradient shrinking Ricci solitons, we also hope that maybe we will be able to answer some questions for those gradient shrinking Ricci solitons, such as, is the scalar curvature always bounded for them? So what we know by the result of Chen, we know that whenever you have an ancient solution to the Ricci flow, it has a positive scalar curvature for all times t. So this is always bigger or equal than zero. So now the question is whether this also holds for any gradient shrinking Ricci soliton. Okay, so that is, for example, the question. And also, we know that for the gradient shrinking Ricci solitons, we know that the volume of these geodesic balls is less or equal than c times r to the n. So it cannot grow faster than the Euclidean growth. And we know that it is, on the other hand, bigger or equal than some little constant c times ln of r. So now the question is, can you actually improve this lower bound? Can you prove that the volume of these geodesic balls grows at least linearly? OK, so here is the proof of theorem. So you take rij squared. So I'll just do it for lambda equals to 1, because then it's easily generalized to any lambda bigger than 0. So then you write that as rij times 1 half gij minus nabla I nabla jf. OK, so and let me choose a cutoff function phi so that phi is 1 on a geodesic ball of radius little r, and phi is 0 outside a ball of radius 2r. And then and gradient of phi is less or equal than the constant over r. Okay. So since I don't know a priori that these integrals exist, I need to multiply everything by a cutoff function. Okay. And now the first part will give you just the scalar times e to the negative f times phi squared. And then in the second integral, you just integrate by parts. And then what you get is plus e to the negative f rij times nabla jf times nabla I phi squared. And you see, when you actually pass this one derivative to e to the negative f times rij, that will be 0. But by this identity, that holds for the Ricci solitons. So if you use that identity, you just get these two terms. OK, so now what you do, you apply Cauchy-Schwarz to the second term. So you get it's less or equal than r e to the negative f phi squared and plus 1 half integral of e to the negative f times rij squared, and then plus some constant times integral e to the negative f grad phi squared and times grad f squared. Okay, so these are the terms that you obtain. And now you can see that this second term you can actually absorb into the term that we started with. And then, okay, so let's analyze what is with this integral of r e to the negative f. So remember that we have r plus grad f squared is f, okay? And by Cao and Zhou, it was recently proven that f actually behaves like the square of a distance. Namely, f is less or equal than 1/4 times r of x plus some constant square, and bigger or equal than 1/4 r of x minus some other constant square, where this r of x is just a distance from a fixed point x0. And this constant c1 and c2 depend on this base point x0. So you see that f grows, actually f behaves like a distance squared over 4. And you know that r is not negative, right? So this is bigger or equal than grad f squared. So that tells you in particular that grad f squared is less or equal than f, which is less or equal than 1/4 times rx squared. So you exactly know how the gradient of f squared behaves, so you can control it. And in particular, this also tells you that the scalar curvature grows at most quadratically. Okay. So now, since you have very good asymptotics on f, you can say that this quantity is bounded. And as I said, you can absorb this into the one that you have here on the left-hand side. And like in the last quantity, you have just to use the behavior of grad f squared. I told you it grows at most quadratically. Then you know that grad phi squared is less or equal than c over the distance squared. So this term, these two terms will cancel each other. And then you end up with e to the negative f. But you see the behavior of f is like this. So integral e to the negative f is bounded also. So that's how you get that theorem A. So theorem B, I mean, it's not difficult, but it's more involved, so I will not discuss it here. So now I want to mention something about the harmonic functions. So I will once again write my Ricci soliton equation, Rij plus nabla I nabla Jf is rho Gij. So now I will not consider only the shrinking Ricci solitons, but also the steady Ricci solitons. So I will allow that rho is bigger or equal than zero. And for my discussion now, I will also need to assume Kähler, which we hope to remove, but we will assume that we are dealing with a Kähler manifold. So then the equation is Rij bar, nabla I nabla j bar is rho Gij bar, and Fij is Fi bar, j bar is zero. Okay, so that will be my setup. And it turns out that actually gradient shrinking and gradient steady Ricci solitons have many properties in common with the complete manifolds with non-negative Ricci curvature. So let me mention the theorem of Yau, which says that if Ricci is bigger or equal than zero on a complete manifold M, and if U is a harmonic function that is bounded, then U has to be constant. Also, if you have a harmonic function with a bounded Dirichlet energy, it has to be constant. So now the question is, does Yau's theorem hold for gradient shrinking Ricci solitons and gradient steady Ricci solitons? Okay. So by a result of Peter Lee, the existence of harmonic functions is related to the structure of the manifold, namely to the number of its ends. Okay. I will discuss also now. So I want to, for that, I want to give a definition. So we will say that M is non-parabolic. If it admits a symmetric positive Green's function. Otherwise, if it's not true, then we say that the manifold is parabolic. Okay? And similarly, you can define the non-parabolic and parabolic ends of a complete manifold. So if you have your manifold, and if you have this end E, and if I denote the boundary by delta E, then we will say that this end is non-parabolic if it admits a symmetric positive Green's function, which satisfies the Neumann boundary condition on the boundary of this end. And the manifold is non-parabolic if and only if it has at least one non-parabolic end. So now here is the theorem. That says the following: if MG is a gradient shrinking or steady reaching solid, okay, so let me first formulate it for shrinking. So is a gradient shrinking reaching soliton, which is also Kähler, and Laplacian u is 0 with integral of grad u squared less than infinity, then u has to be constant. Okay. As a corollary, you have the following, that every gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, which is also Kähler, has at most one non-parabolic end. And I will also mention let me call theorem C and theorem D. So I will also mention that theorem C and D hold also for steady solitons, so for gradient steady Ricci solitons. Okay, let me start with a proposition that says the following. So if the scalar curvature is bounded by some number alpha, which is strictly less than n half minus 1, then all ends of M, which is a gradient shrinking or gradient steady Ricci soliton, have to be non-parabolic. And the proof of that proposition is very easy. Namely, take again the potential function of your soliton F, and let's define A to be n half minus 1 minus alpha, which is strictly bigger than 0. And you can just consider F to the negative A. So let's take this function and compute the Laplacian. When you compute the Laplacian, you can show that it is less or equal than 0. So you have a superharmonic function, and due to known asymptotics of f, I'm just restricting myself to shrinking solitons, right? Because in the case of shrinking solitons, we know the exact asymptotics of this f, which behaves like distance squared, so which means that this goes to zero as the distance approaches plus infinity. And now by a result of Lee and Tam, so by a result of Peter Lee and Tam, it follows that all ends have to be non-parabolic, and then in particular your manifold is non-parabolic. So all ends are non-parabolic. You see now, like, so then I will just say that this bound n over 2 minus 1 is sharp, because you have this example as n minus 2 cross R2, where you take R2 to be a Gaussian solid, Gaussian soliton which is flat. And if you consider this, this is a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton for which the scalar curvature is exactly n over 2 minus 1, and it has parabolic ends. So now you see that if, for example, your manifold M is a gradient shrinking Ricci soliton which is scalar, and if R is less than n over 2 minus 1, then it is connected at infinity. This is just an observation. OK, why is that so? Because if you have this bound on the scalar curvature, by the proposition, we know that all n's have to be non-parabolic. And then by theorem D, we know that every such manifold can have at most one non-parabolic end. So that immediately tells you that such a manifold has to be connected at infinity. OK, let me just briefly tell you how the proofs go. I mean, I'll just outline the main steps. The proof of theorem C. Okay. Okay, so we start with the harmonic function and bounded Dirichlet energy. So we have our Ricci soliton equations. And the first step is to show that U is pluriharmonic. That is, you show that U alpha beta bar is a 0 for such a function. I mean, and you can easily do that by using the similar trick that I've explained earlier, by using the same cutoff function and by using this condition that you have a bounded Dirichlet energy. So once you know that your function is pluriharmonic, so let's consider function f, which is just grad f dotted with grad u, which is just u alpha f alpha bar. F is, again, our potential function. So you consider that function. OK, and by considering the integral of grad f squared, we show that f has to be constant. OK. Now you have that such a function f has to be constant, but we know also the exact asymptotics of this little f, right? Because this little f goes to infinity as your distance goes to infinity. That means that it has to attain the minimum somewhere inside. That means that there exists a point at which this gradient vanishes. And that, and knowing that this big f is a constant function, tells you that actually f has to be 0 identically. OK. So once you know that, you can consider the f Laplacian of grad u. And let me just define what the f Laplacian is. So f Laplacian of some function h, we define to be the regular Laplacian minus grad f grad h. Okay, so it is actually the Laplacian, which it's a self-adjoint operator with respect to this measure e to the negative f dv. Okay. So if you consider this quantity, you can actually show that it is bigger or equal than 1/2 grad u squared by using that f is identically zero. Okay, and now you just do some integration by parts here, and you can conclude that u has to be a constant function. Okay, so that's how the proof goes for the shrinking solitons. For the steady solitons, it is very similar. It's actually all the same up to this point here, because the equation for a steady soliton is Rij is nabla I, nabla jf. And you remember for shrinking soliton, it was Rij plus this Hessian equals to something. So that means that you will have to change a sign here, and you will also not have this term. So what you will obtain is that nabla u times Laplacian negative f grad u is bigger or equal than zero. So you will not be able to conclude immediately that u is constant, because in the case of steady solitons, you even don't know that the volume of such a manifold is infinite, which is conjectured to be true, but as far as I know, nobody has proved that. So you have to do something else. Namely, you can prove this identity, which says that the integral of gradient of grad u squared, grad f, is negative integral of grad u squared times the scalar curvature. I mean, naively, you can just here integrate by parts. So imagine that you are on a compact manifold. You just integrate here by parts and take the trace of your soliton equation, which will tell you that Laplacian f is equal to r, and you obtain this. But since you are on a complete manifold and you don't know that these integrals are finite, you have to do it by cutoff functions and do some little estimates. But in any case, you can end up with something like that. And then what you obtain, and then you can obtain this. You can obtain that the integral of grad u squared plus 1/2 integral of r grad u squared is less or equal than zero. And now this will force this gradient grad u squared to be identically zero and r grad u squared to be identically equal to zero. So the first thing will tell you that gradient of u is a constant. So if that constant is zero, you are done, because it will tell you that u has to be constant itself. If that is not the case, then the second equation will force r to be identically equal to zero. So if c is zero, then we are done. So if c is different from zero, that will force r to be identically equal to zero. But since the Ricci soliton is also the equation, is also a solution to the Ricci flow equation, and we know that the scalar curvature evolves by d dt r is Laplace r plus 2 Ricci squared. If r is identically equal to zero, that will tell you that Ricci has to be equal to zero. And now you are in the situation of Yau's theorem, which tells you if Ricci is bigger or equal than zero, then every harmonic function which is bounded has to be constant, and you are done again. Just apply Yau's theorem. Okay, and let me just tell you one sentence for the proof of theorem D. Theorem D says that every gradient shrinking Ricci soliton, which is scalar, can have at most one non-parabolic end. So you argue by contradiction, assume it has two non-parabolic ends. Then if you use some results of Li and Tam, you can construct a non-trivial harmonic function with bounded Dirichlet energy. And by a theorem C, that's not possible. would just say that. So say if your manifold has two non-parabolic ends, let's say E and F, then U can be constructed as a limit. So here, I will say this is a ball BRI. So as a limit of harmonic functions UI, such that UI is 1 on E intersected with the boundary of a ball of radius RI, and UI is 0 on the other ball, on F intersected with this ball of radius RI. So, I mean, you have to use a little bit the arguments of Li and Tam, and I mean, prove that this limit of UIs will be non-constant and that will have this bounded Dirichlet energy. And as I said, it will contradict theorem C. Okay, so I think I'll stop here.
Questions? No questions? Okay, thank you very much, Professor.